Thank you, Mr. President. I move that this report be noted.
The Honourable Ms. Franks.
Mr. President, it gives me great pleasure to today table and speak to the interim report of the Joint Committee on the Legalisation of Medicinal Cannabis. Members in this place would be well aware that for a very long period of time in this place, I have certainly championed the legalisation of medicinal cannabis, which I was pleased to see happen at a federal level, the legalisation of industrial hemp, which contains very little THC for those industrial purposes, and the legalisation of cannabis. However, this report that I speak to today is that of a committee that is not just comprised, of course, of a Greens Member of Parliament, although I am very pleased to chair it and thank the members of that committee for their support working on this very important issue of addressing the challenges that we continue to face where a previously prohibited substance has now been legalised and is approved for use in a medicinal capacity. There still remains big shortfalls in our laws, our policies and our procedures. I particularly want to thank the members of the committee, and I note that the committee has been populated in this place by the Honourable Ben Hood and the Honourable Justin Hanson. So from this particular chamber, we have a Labor, a Liberal and a Green. In the other place, we've had two independents, initially the member for Mount Gambier and now the member for Narunga has replaced him, Mr. Fraser Ellis, MP, Mr. Eddie Hughes, member for Giles, and the Honourable David Pizzoni, member for Unley. So there in that place, we have an independent, a Labor and a Liberal. So this is actually a committee comprised of quite a good cross-selection of the Parliament, both regional, rural and metro, and most of the parties that are represented in this place. I do note not all, but I think it's made for a very good debate, and certainly I draw not just members of this council's attention, but we will be drawing ministers' attention to the issues that we have raised for further consideration. There has been in this report 13 recommendations called for in our interim report by this joint committee, and certainly those amendments are not those recommendations are not necessarily ones that the Greens would progress in and of themselves, but they are in many ways a sensible compromise arrived at through thorough deliberation, evidence and debate within that very diverse committee. The first of the recommendations is the one that possibly will attract the most media interest, and that is recommendation one, which calls for the Minister for Infrastructure and Transport to prepare draft amendments to the Road Traffic Act to provide that it will not be an offence to drive with THC present in oral fluid or blood where drivers, one, have been prescribed medicinal cannabis products containing THC in accordance with the Controlled Substance Act or a corresponding act of another state or territory. Two, are using their medication in accordance with the prescription. Three, have zero blood alcohol concentration. And four, are not impaired. And further, part B of that recommendation, that the Minister for Infrastructure and Transport undertake community consultation in respect of the amendments as proposed above. Members of this council will remember that I've previously had a private members bill before this place, and indeed former member, the Honourable Kelly Vincent, has moved similar amendments, and currently we have a bill before this place under the auspices of One Nation and the Honourable Sarah Game that goes some way to addressing this question of how we can have patients continue to be criminalised taking a lawful legal drug as per their prescription from their medical professionals and yet still be criminalised, not for any impairment, not for any real reasons of road safety concern, but simply for having the presence of THC in their system. The police in this state have roadside drug testing. That regime does not test for levels of THC. It simply tests for simple presence. It's either there or it's not. And yet SAPOL themselves in their advertising say We will catch you long after the high is gone. And that is because THC stays in your system for a very long time, well after its psychoactive effects have been felt and experienced, and certainly the evidence that we heard from experts across the medical profession and the legal profession, well after any danger is there to either patient or public of that THC being in that driver's system. We think that this is an issue that has been managed quite well in Tasmania, where just by chance and their circumstances of their laws, drivers in that state already have this defence. And since the legalisation of medicinal cannabis, their roads have not seen unprecedented levels of dangers and crashes. They have not had any heightened road safety risk from patients with a prescription medication using that medication in an appropriate way, but also appropriately driving when they are able to. In this state, because cannabis remains a prohibited substance, and THC in particular, rather than CBD, remains a prohibited substance, we have a road system based not on real road safety, but based on the criminalisation of that THC. This simply doesn't add up if we want to treat patients as patients and not as criminals. These people are not criminals and we should not be criminalising them. We do think, however, as a committee, that this is not a job for the Greens, it's not a job for One Nation, and it's not a job for people like Dignity, MLC, the Honourable Kelly Vincent to take up. It is a job for the government of the day, with all of the tools that they have at their disposal to do the proper consultation, to weed through, not to make a pun, but I'm sure there'll be a few more. I didn't mean to make that one, I do apologise. To weed through fact from fiction, to look at Tasmania, to look at jurisdictions around the world where their laws and their history of prohibition has not unduly and unjustly continued to criminalise patients who simply wish to be able to operate a vehicle in a safe manner so that they can go about their lives, that they can keep their jobs, particularly if they're a rural or regional patient, they can maintain their livelihood. And indeed, often, the choice that we give them currently is a terrible one where they are unable to continue the medication that has worked for them to alleviate their symptoms, such as, say, pain. And we force them onto far more concerning drugs that are less safe on our roads, such as opioids. So the realities here really need to be investigated by this government. And that's why recommendation one, I do hope that the Malinauskas government will take some leadership and pursue that process of drafting a bill. And certainly there's been several already before this parliament for them to take as a starting point, and then doing the proper consultation advised by health professionals and true road safety professionals, and putting aside the stigma and the hyperbole and the polemics around this, where we literally have road safety ads that say we will get you long after the high is gone, knowing that in fact that is not a road safety provision, that is simply a further criminalisation of cannabis provision where somebody has THC in their system. The pharmacists and the doctors and others have shown us that there are pathways here to establish that defence for those drivers. It works in Tasmania. Curiously, in our evidence, we actually heard a situation of a particular driver in Tasmania who was not able to avail themselves of the defence because they'd used a pharmacy from another state or territory. And so they were left without the pathway of proving that their medicinal cannabis was indeed dispensed and used appropriately. That is an anomaly in that law in Tasmania, and I certainly hope that they address that. But here we have far more work to do than Tasmania, and we can look to them for their lead. Recommendation two, that consideration be given by the Minister for Infrastructure and Transport to the monitoring of technologies or methods developed for the purposes of assessment of impairment, with the potential for implementation in respect of enforcement of offences where impairment is an element of the offence. where more accurate technologies or methods are identified, procurement, where necessary, and introduction of such technologies or methods must occur as a matter of priority. Simply put, the testing regime we currently use for our roadside tests only tests for presence of THC. It does not test for impairment. Unlike our alcohol testing system, it does not look at levels, and it does not use not just the technologies, but in fact some of the old traditional methods of assessing impairment or lack of impairment. Recommendation 3, that consideration be given by the Minister for Industrial Relations and Public Sector to the necessity of specific regulation of workers where it is unlawful for such workers to undertake their duties with THC present in oral fluid or blood. That consideration be given to providing for such workers to undertake their duties where they A, have been prescribed medicinal cannabis products containing THC in accordance with the Controlled Substances Act or a corresponding act of another state or territory. B, are using their medication in accordance with prescription. C, have zero blood alcohol concentration. And D, are not impaired. This is a body of work for the Minister in this place, the Minister for Industrial Relations, to take on. We need work health and safety policies that truly keep workers safe. And when we have a return to work system that allows patients to access medicinal cannabis, that sees that it works, that assists them to be in the workplace, we also have to have workplace policies that allow them to continue taking their medication in a safe way in those workplaces. Again, the history of prohibition, the stigma, often needs to be addressed. This is possibly a more direct conversation that the Minister for Industrial Relations can institute amongst workplaces, because some workplaces in this state are already managing this issue. And indeed, we have heard evidence of some workplaces where somebody can operate heavy machinery inside the gate because they're a medicinal cannabis patient, but the appropriate workplace health and safety provisions have been put in place, but they can't actually drive to work to go through that gate to then do their job. It's a ludicrous situation again, where on one side of the gate, they're deemed fit and capable, despite our archaic criminalisation of cannabis over the years. And inside the gate, outside the gate, they're seen as criminals by the police, just simply because of our historical provisions. It's a ludicrous situation. It does need to be addressed. And there's a body of work there for the Minister for Industrial Relations to do. So we do call on him to take a look at that. He also is required under this recommendation to consider he introduced a requirement that PCBUs must treat medicinal cannabis in the same way as other prescribed drugs, with the potential to cause impairment when drafting and enforcing work health and safety policies. Such reform, of course, is appropriately to be accompanied by the funding of an education program for the benefit of PCBUs and health and safety representatives who wish to better understand the risks or potential benefits that may arise from allowing employees who are not subject to specific regulation prohibiting the presence of THC, noting recommendation 3, to undertake their duties where they, and again, A, have been prescribed medicinal cannabis products containing THC in accordance with the Controlled Substances Act or a corresponding act of another state or territory, B, are using their medication in accordance with the prescription, C, have zero blood alcohol concentration, and D, are not impaired. Recommendation 5 of this interim report says that at A and B, subject to part B of this recommendation, that consideration be given by the Minister for Health and Wellbeing to the amendment of the Controlled Substances Act to exclude medicinal cannabis products from those that are subject to Section 18A, 1A requirements, and B, where a patient is known to be drug dependent or there is reasonable cause to believe the same, a requirement to obtain authorisation from SA Health under Section 18A, 1A to prescribe a medicinal cannabis product containing THC remains appropriate. Recommendation 6 is also for the Minister for Health and Wellbeing, and it calls on him to undertake an assessment of the potential benefits that may result from the introduction of uniform dispensing requirements for medicinal cannabis products. Recommendation 7 asks for the Minister for Health and Wellbeing to undertake an assessment of the potential benefits that may result from the introduction of uniform standards for the purposes of transportation and storage of medicinal cannabis products across our state and nation. Recommendation 8 also calls on the Minister for Health and Wellbeing to write to the Australian Minister for Health and Aged Care to note evidence received in respect to eligibility for Medicare benefits for telehealth consultations by GPs, namely that the requirement for a, quote, established clinical relationship, end quote, to be in existence has the potential to limit affordable access to online cannabis clinics and consequently to medicinal cannabis products. To propose to the Australian Minister for Health and Aged Care that he give consideration to removing this requirement where a medical practice is located more than 80 kilometres from that patient's principal place of residence or consults patients only by way of telehealth. Certainly opening up access to those medical professionals who are educated and skilled and able to prescribe medicinal cannabis products certainly will go a long way to assisting patients in this state. And of course, that is an issue because when most of our GPs went through university and studied health and medicine, cannabis, of course, was only viewed as an illicit substance. It was not a medicinal substance able to be prescribed. And so, in fact, often their knowledge of it is not as strong as it could be, and there is a body of educational work to do there. But until all doctors are able to be skilled up, that telehealth option is actually more important for this than for many other drugs. Recommendation 9, so that patients being treated with medicinal cannabis are not disadvantaged by admission to a South Australian hospital, that consideration be given by the Minister for Health and Wellbeing to amendment of any protocols applicable in South Australian hospitals as necessary to provide that medicinal cannabis may A, be dispensed from hospital pharmacies, B, if lawfully dispensed by an external pharmacy, be self-supplied by an inpatient, and C, be consumed on hospital premises by an inpatient where it can be administered in a way that does not impact on the health or safety of others. Recommendation 10 also calls for the Minister for Health and Wellbeing to consider providing logistical assistance and support to the medicinal cannabis industry to provide access to medicinal cannabis products on a compassionate basis in our state. Time and time again, this committee, we have heard that where medicinal cannabis patients are able to work their way through the health system, access a prescription, quite often the product is simply unaffordable, and certainly on an ongoing basis, unaffordable and unsustainable. The medicinal cannabis industry recognises this and runs some ad hoc programs. One in particular that I thought was quite worthy and meritorious was one for endometriosis patients who deal with chronic pain. And indeed, medicinal cannabis there has been proven to be quite life-changing and life-enabling for those people. By using the systems of SA Health, our government could go a long way to ensuring that medicinal cannabis products that are available through the industry, particularly where there is excess stock, can be accessed by those most in need, getting those patients most in need the medication that they need at a price that they can afford. That is something that our state government could step up and ensure happens, and it is something that the industry is calling for governments to assist with. Recommendation 11, that the Minister for Health and Wellbeing give consideration to the introduction of an aggravated offence of supplying cannabis where the supply is by way of use of packaging or labelling that may give the appearance to the supplied cannabis has been lawfully dispensed in accordance with the prescription to protect the integrity of the medicinal cannabis regime. And indeed, that is an area where, of course, there are charlatans entering the market, and we do want to make sure that people who seek what is now a lawful prescription medication are getting the medication that they need that has been prescribed for them. We are concerned that the further criminalisation, however, of cannabis and the fact that medicinal cannabis hasn't necessarily been given the supports that it needs so far, opening the way up and opening the doors to those particular charlatans. The recommendation 12, that consideration be given by the Minister for Industry, Innovation and Science to review South Australia's planning laws for the purpose of seeking to identify options to remove or minimise unnecessary barriers to and to optimise benefits obtained by establishing medicinal cannabis businesses in South Australia, where they are operating pursuant to licences and permits issued under the Narcotic Drugs Act 1967 of the Commonwealth. I hope that the Minister for Planning there will give consideration to that. Again, it's a legacy of a system where cannabis was criminalised, but now medicinal cannabis often has to operate as if they are criminals, unnecessarily, needlessly, and we are getting in the way of industry and business flourishing in this state. Then finally, we also, recommendation 13, call on the Minister for Industry, Innovation and Science to establish collaborative relationships, including grants between the Government of South Australia and academic institutions for the purposes of furthering research into potential benefits and risks that may arise from the use of medicinal cannabis, with particular focus in the areas of industrial relations, health and road safety. Now, I would say that driving and medicinal cannabis seems to be one of the most studied subjects on the planet, and that there is a wealth of information should any government be seeking it. And certainly I recommend to anyone in this country to just start with the Lambert Initiative, but then work your way right around the nation. There is a lot of work being done here. There is, of course, more that could be done, and certainly in that area of work health and safety, I hope a Labor government with a record of innovating, with having supported appropriate and considered conversations around industrial hemp, as well as medicinal cannabis in the past, will see that this is an opportunity not only to support their citizens, but to see this area flourish in our state as a clean, green industry that shows compassion and cares for patients rather than criminalises them. With that, I commend the report to the Council.
Mr. Hunter.